Jason, hi.
Good morning, how are you?
Good, how's everything now? What are you, 1 hour difference?
Yes, not a hell of a lot of difference, but...
But all those miles, yeah, because you're in the same time zone,
yes.
It feels much closer to home.
It does, actually, as I say, but we're a good 10 hours away from you.
Well, I'm coming to South Africa at the end of the year.
Well, wonderful.
It's going to be my first trip.
Oh, great.
I'm going to be going, to Cape Town, and I'm going to Garonga, which is some...
Lovely.
On a safari.
Lovely, yeah, we're in Cape Town, so you've got a lot to look forward to, because Tony's been out a couple of times.
That's right, he has.
Yes, so it'll be good.
We never made it down there, you know.
No, the 80s, so, yeah. Thanks for nothing.
Politically, very different.
Yes,
way.
Yes, no, sure, we had issues, which I think we've
faced.
Yes, and are resolving, so, which is good. So it's just...
So the record's done well here. We went in at number 8.
Yes, that's right.
Which has been really exciting, you know.
Which I think is great. I think it just shows you that the Spandau Ballet legacy lives on.
Yeah, I was just telling Louise, because I was watching the football last night, West Ham Tottenham. And,
right.
And the West Ham fans were singing Gold to one of their players, whose name is Cole.
Okay.
And I was shocked the first time we'd made the terraces in 20 years.
It just shows you. I wonder what it took, you know, that they sort of believed it good enough or
it's funny,
worthy.
Isn't it? You know, after all this time.
Yes.
That obviously someone picked up on the name and thought that they could do it, and it's worked.
Yes, and you should quickly trademark that again and get the royalties people involved.
Right, unfortunately, you can't claim PRS from football fans.
That's a shame, isn't it? But congratulations on, on the greatest hits, or the best thereof. I think, obviously, looking back on it, quite a sentimental album, I'm sure, for you, you know, to be, obviously, to see out and to see, you know, all those tracks in one place and going,
yeah.
My God, we did do it.
I think there was a, you know, there was never an announcement that we'd finished and went off and did movies and then time went by and, you know, we ended up in court last year and there was a bit of a sort of a legal tussle. And I think, you know, once all the court thing was finished and resolved, and the turn of the century more than anything, because now the 90s are over, and the 90s were never going to be favourable towards the decade previous.
No.
I think it felt right that we, you know, just put out the package, as it were, the canon, or the album that was spent, and just to sort of remind people of what we did. And, you know, and what shocked us is how, you know, strong people's memories are of those songs. I guess those songs have tended to live on, you know, through people like PM Dawn or the Backstreet Boys doing a version of it on their last album. And, you know, people have been sort of very responsive, because I think they see us very much as being synonymous with that decade, you know, and our first single was 1980, our last single 1990.
I mean, at the time of doing it, I mean, you know, it all seemed like a very neatly sort of put together plan on, you know, taking these lads and creating a band and sort of following the route that you would take, you know, to become international stars.
Well, it seems like that, but I mean, we were all, you know, we were running ourselves. There were no Svengalis, no A&R men involved. You know, this was. We were above and beyond any band that had probably come before us. We were utterly in control of our destiny. And I think we surprised the record company with the sort of ideas we had at the time. Our manager was the same age as us. And came from the same school. We were just a bunch of working class kids out of North London. We went hand in hand at the beginning of the 80s with a cult scene that was sort of...
Yes.
You know, which was a sort of post-punk sort of reaction, really. And we became the house band of that scene.
Yes.
And there was a kind of fervour about it where people... See, pop music was everything in the early 80s, in the late 70s. There wasn't the same sort of enthusiasm for film. because video didn't exist.
That's right.
There wasn't. There was certainly no computer games.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
No.
All there was pop culture, youth culture, and people were wondering what the next big thing was going to be. And these strangely dressed kids out of North London.
And you were strangely dressed. I mean, you must admit. I mean, and you were strangely dressed.
Well, we were, but I mean, I think our biggest influence probably was you know, as kids we grew up with David Bowie and glam rock.
Yes.
You know, and then punk was something that was slightly outrageous. So
true.
I think we'd always kind of felt that pop music and youth culture always had to be slightly outrageous and but we never saw ourselves when we were dressing like that. There were lots of kids dressing like that.
That's the thing. That was the fashion. I mean,
that was the fashion.
Yeah,
you know, we were sort of at the forefront of it.
You were. I mean, this is. I mean, when I look back at the VH1 videos, I sort of, you know, I balk at the fact that we did dress like them and we were proud of it.
But there was a musical difference as well. And
absolutely.
I think the key was taking dance music and dance music drums and bass and mixing that with guitars. And rather sort of much more European sounding synthesizers.
Mm.
And in those days, you couldn't play more than one note on a synthesizer.
Yeah.
So, you know, the riff was everything.
Mm.
And that combination of, you see, because there was such a over here, pop music and rock music never ever discussed dance music, disco. That was something that other people did. You know?
Yes.
So there was this coming together of the two genres, and with what we were doing, really, and then eventually with what Duran were doing, and it went on and on.
Because I mean, I think what Spandau Ballet did and continued to do, you know, throughout the, you know, your career was, it wasn't straight pop, as you say. It was very sophisticated, almost in some respects, maybe. More than what people expected, because you were breaking ground with every single track that you released. It wasn't typical pop. It wasn't, you know.
It was unusual. I mean, with chart number one, you know, we really did to go back to our sort of funk roots, which was quite, again, fairly subversive. But and then True was one of those first records that a white band made that got played on black radio stations in America.
Mm.
And I remember going into one of the black radio stations in America, and they were all surprised that we were black. White.
White, you know?
So I think that crossover in music was what made the music so successful, and why, you know, and also the other thing was these bands, like ourselves and Duran and Culture Club and Human League, were America never had these groups.
Mm, true.
And that's why, you know, they sort of lapped us up, really. You know, we were doing very well in America and the rest of Europe.
Because
this was something new. I guess now, you know, when England doesn't have any success in America, it's because the English bands, or group boy bands, really, are just trying to do rather soft versions of what's already coming out of America.
Yes.
So I think it was a time of certainly, you know, great sort of enthusiasm culturally for the English, you know, because we were doing so well all over the world.
Yes, yeah. But I mean, the songs that you wrote, were they written purely in the way that you wanted to write them, or was it with intent in the sense that you were trying to do, yeah, that you were trying to do something different?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting question. I think the first album, there was an intent to do something different, you know, but out of my influences of bands like Kraftwerk, and then with the second album, again, to kind of, to stay a cult, urban London group, you know, but I think by the end of that, there really was, you know, well, you can't stay a cult forever, can't posture yourself in that way, forever, because all these kids now weren't interested. We've been on TV too much, you know, we couldn't stay a cult. There was a sense of relief when I sat down to write the True album, really, because, you know, I'd been writing songs since I was 11 and buying pop music since I was 11. And I sat down, I just literally wrote a bunch of songs that were, you know, really true to me, you know, if you excuse the pun. And from my heart, and just... And I knew we couldn't record this album in London. The place, we had to go somewhere else to record it. And we chose Compass Point because I thought there was some really interesting sort of blue-eyed soul coming out of Compass Point, you know, with Robert Palmer.
Yes.
Tom Tom Club.
Yes.
And, you know, it changed our lives, you know, by leaving London and going to Nassau to make that album, we virtually didn't come back home for the next 7 years. Yeah. And I think we found our sound out there. You know, Steve had moved on to the saxophone, and there was a we were exploring the production techniques that were new. We used producers Swain and Jolly, who worked previously with a black soul band called Imagination.
Yes.
These were two white guys. So there was a nice crossover of cultures. And sorry, I hope it's not too close to home, talking of white and black.
Not at all. Not at all. No, not at all. Not at all.
And so it was, it began our journey, really. I mean, after that, I suppose there is a sense of, you know, you've got to keep it up. You know, you've got to keep people satisfied, you know. And for me as a songwriter, the pressure was, you know, I've got to write something as successful as True.
Yes.
And I think you've got to accept that you maybe won't. You know, we could have been a successful band without the song True.
True.
By pure chance, you know, I wrote a song that ended up being, you know, just hugely important to a lot of people in their personal lives.
Yes.
Because the amount of people who come up to me still to this day, and sort of that song, you know, meant everything to me when I met my, you know,
your partner.
So, and you can't compete with yourself, and you just have to keep writing songs that are true to you. So, and it worked for another 7 years.
Yes, because I mean that obviously stands out as probably one of the high points, you know, in the band's history. Because I mean, from then on out, how did you approach the whole process to say not better yourself, but at least maintain what at that point people obviously then had an expectation of the band.
Well, I think the band had a sound, you know, and we were going to continue with that. I don't know. I just kept writing songs and seeing how they worked, and hoping that the influences would evolve. And the inspiration. We had an album here called Through the Barricades, which.
Yeah.
Actually, we didn't release in Africa.
That's right.
South Africa. But that I'd written in Ireland, and the song Through the Barricades, which was very successful here, was obviously directly influenced by the sort of civil problems in Belfast.
Yes.
You know, it's kind of Romeo and Juliet.
Yes.
Sort of song, which I guess in many ways could have worked very well down in your country at that time.
It was played extensively. That was the funny thing.
Was it?
It was. Yeah, it was a huge hit.
Well, I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah, there's a certain irony there, but yes, it was.
I know, because actually I spoke to someone out of South Africa not so long ago who said that, you know, kids would still kind of get the posters and the pictures and the magazines.
Very much. Very much so. I mean, as I say, I mean, there was a steady diet of smash hits and, you know.
Was there sort of a sense of, you know, why are some bands refusing not to?
Very much. I mean, we used to actually, I mean, there was a time, I think probably, you know, when Spandau Ballet was at its, you know, at its highest point, that, I mean, we were getting NME and Melody Maker every week, but you would have major censorship going through the paper, you know, that they'd literally by hand taken, you know, black cokey pens. And actually, I mean, I remember reading an interview with George Michael, and it was a case of they had literally hand edited out all the bits that could have potentially been, you know, in any way, you know, leading. It's insane when you think about it on the back of it. But no, I mean,
do you think that Western pop music and the stance that was taken occasionally was all went to help in the end?
Absolutely. I mean, I think it was a huge escape. I mean, as I say, I mean, I'm 31, and at the time, you know, I mean, you know, Spandau Ballet, you know, Duran Duran, all of that. I mean, that was pure escapism for, you know, for a lot of kids, because, you know, and they bought into, you know, into the whole fashion and to, you know, into the music and to the whole message behind it, you know, in order to try and relate to something other than the situations that they were in.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we had a song chart number one, and there were three black horn players, you know, and so this kind of thing must have been, you know, obviously subversive, you know.
It would have been, but as I say, not by the people listening to it, but more by the government of the day.
That was the funny
part, is that the perception always was that it was the people, and it wasn't the people. I mean, it was almost reactionary, but not to the point that you obviously had any kind of revolution. But but it was a very interesting time, and I mean, I think the whole British, because there is and always has been a very strong British population in this country. People were going backwards and forwards, and of course, Through the Barricades wasn't released here. but people were getting it. You know, I mean, people were going backwards and forwards to the UK, bringing it back. They were importing it. And so, I mean, Spandau Ballet was, you know, was certainly one of the, you know, one of the 80s bigger, you know, biggest bands in this country as well.
Sure.
Just the only difference was that obviously we couldn't get, you know, get the likes at that point, you know, because of the situation. But no, very important band. I mean, I think for a lot of people, as you say, with a track like True, it meant a lot to a lot of people. But when I think back to when I was buying Spandau Ballet records, it was a very important time.
Shame we didn't go, but I'm looking forward to coming anyway.
Yes, no, absolutely.
Go ahead anyway.
At what point did everything sort of start to fall apart, though?
I suppose there was a feeling when the new decade was coming that, you know, in my mind, I felt that we had run our course, you know, that we were going to find it a struggle. Because, you know, pop music is very much defined by decade, and as all sort of pop culture is, and we were synonymous with the 80s. My brother and I had been offered to do the movie about the Cray Twins.
Remember that?
Which we decided to go and do. And in a way, we just never came back. I think, you know, some of the band were a little bit nervous about the fact that we were going to make a movie. And there was obviously, you know, a certain amount of fear, because 10 years was a long time of a band doing well. I think it's an awful long time. And I think, you know, for me, it was like I didn't know whether I wanted to be in that gang anymore. And I wanted to go off and try some other things. And I went off to Hollywood and I did The Bodyguard and Killing Zoe for Tarantino. And so, you know, and then you know, my brother fell ill. He had a brain tumor, but he's now a huge star in this country.
Yes.
Which is difficult to... I mean, I don't know whether you get EastEnders.
We do, yeah.
You do.
We do.
he is huge here. You know, he's had a successful book, which has been in the best-selling... top 10 best-selling non-fiction books for the last 4 months.
So,
you know, this guy is certainly... You know, there aren't many bass players in rock and roll that end up having third and fourth careers.
True. But, I mean...
But I suppose we just... It never... And there came a time much in later in the 80s, in the 90s, when I think, you know, it's hard to give up a band. It's hard to find another life. You know, when you've been in a band and you've experienced such highs that we did, and you've lived with each other through such extraordinary fantasy, to face real world or to try and outrun the shadow of the group, all these things are very difficult.
Yes.
So I think... You know, it affects people differently, and like a marriage when it breaks down, you know, there is that sense of people having different versions of their own history. And we ended up, unfortunately, having a bit of an argument about finances in court, which, you know, something I didn't want to happen, but it went all the way to court, and, you know, became quite bitter. But these things aren't uncommon. But, you know, I talked to you about those 10 years. And I can honestly say that none of it is tainted for me, because that there were no signs of that happening then.
No.
And this is all, you know, stuff you know, that's going on now, as now we're older guys.
Yes.
But in a way, the fact that we didn't carry the band on past 1990, I think, was a good thing.
I think
we went out pretty much on a high.
Definitely.
You know, we hadn't sort of, we didn't keep trying to release albums that failed.
No.
And I think, you know, we, in that sense, we respected what we'd created.
Because, I mean, I can remember being in the UK, I think, at the time that it was announced, well, you know, I mean, not that it was so formally announced, but that the band was gone. And I can't remember the group that was almost, that came in on the back of it, because obviously on the back of Spandau Ballet, there were all these, you know, I mean, it was the beginning of the boy band sort of syndrome that we, you know, that we suffer today.
Well, I guess after us, I mean, there was a bit of a lull for a while, and there wasn't really until 94, 95 when Oasis and Blur and the Britpop thing happened.
Yes.
You know, and there is a sense now in this country, only 5 years later, that's all finished.
Yes.
You know, which is extraordinary, really.
It is. It just shows you that the cycle seemed to be getting shorter and shorter.
Well, I think there's a lot of media to feed.
Yes. You know?
And also, the other thing is that these bands didn't sell records outside of the UK.
No.
They were forever on our doorstep.
Yes.
Where, like, with us and Duran, we'd promote an album briefly in England, and then we'd go off, and then we'd go for 10 months.
Yes.
You know, around the world. So there was a sense that we weren't.
mean, as musicians, I mean, I know Tony's done it, to try and to stand on your own as musicians and to try and, well, probably not to get the same sort of accolade, but to do it on your own. It's almost a, I think, in, especially in Tony's case, he battled even more so. I don't know, I mean, as much as he was respected as being, you know, as being a part of Spandau Ballet, it could never be the same, though.
Well, you know, there's no precedent of anybody, you know, leaving bands and trying to, and apart from Sting.
Yes, true.
You know, because,
yeah, true.
I mean, you know, we're talking about Freddie Mercury, Mick Jagger. I mean, you know, there are very few singers actually that can really be as successful as the band. The band is the gang everyone wanted to see. You know, it's the name you're associated with. And as individuals, you're seen often as less than, you know, the sum of the parts.
Yes. Yeah.
I've got someone looking at me, and I'm sure.
Yes, it's time to go. It's time to go. But thank you very much.
It's a pleasure talking to you.
Likewise, and also congratulations on one part of your many careers.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I'd love to see a copy. I'm sure that you'll send my.
It will be sent through. Yes, it will.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Do you need to speak to her, or are you? You finished now.
I think we're done.
No, we're done. All right, all the best.
Have a good day.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.